Thanks everyone for coming. My name is Oliver. I'm a postdoc at the Harvard Business School and affiliate of the Behavioural Insights Group at Harvard, and I'm running a course called EPIC, the Experimental Pitch Innovation Competition. And as part of that, and as part of big seminar series that always brings in exciting speakers, we're excited to have two exciting speakers here today, both flown in from the UK, although not both of them are from the UK. This is Michael Sanders on Glazebrook. Michael is actually from the UK, from Bristol, far, far away, where it rains a lot. But he's now in London and he heads up the Behavioural Insights team's research group. He's actually the chief scientist there, has been with BID for quite a while now. His unit is particularly responsible for designing the big RCTs that they are running, the analysis, the stats, a lot of methodological details behind it. And the students that are in here, some of you guys are in this EPIC competition workshop. Hopefully, this will be an opportunity to ask a lot of questions around things, you know, how they work in the real world. So they use that opportunity. Michael used to be a postdoc here at the Harvard Kennedy School a few years ago, and he's now also an assistant professor at Oxford University. And Kate Glazebrook is also with the Behavioural Insights team. She's from Australia originally, and she now heads up a spin-off from the Behavioural Insights team called Applied, which is a platform that allows recruiters to make the recruitment process fairer, more transparent, and less biased. And she's going to talk a lot more about that as well. And she was also here at HKS, so I guess we have good reason to bring both of them back into this room. She did her MPP a few years ago and has since been at the Behavioural Insights team. So with that, thanks so much for coming. And we're going to start with Michael and then Kate. But this should be, again, as always, fairly interactive. So if you have any questions, shout out and introduce yourself briefly before asking a question.
Thanks, Omar, for that introduction. So, in bearing in mind the fact that you have a lot of prestigious speakers who come to talk here and the quality is very high, I think we're going to aim to hit the average quality of your talks over the two of us. So I'm going to be very, very bad, and then Kate is going to be significantly better than the average talk, and therefore it'll come out okay. But because of the peak end effect, you guys are going to remember the entire experience as having been brilliant. That's the idea. So I am Michael Saunders. As Oliver says, I'm chief scientist at BIT, which basically means I'm in charge of all of the geeky, nerdy parts of BIT, which is a really great job. I think many of my colleagues think they're geeky and nerdy, however, they have much less algebra on their bedroom walls, so I feel like I win. So, not a joke. So I can talk very briefly about what the Behavioural Insights team are. I'm sure many of you will know who we are, and then talk a little bit about trials and how we got into doing trials. Then talk a bit more about one of our particular programs of work that I find particularly interesting, and then I'm going to stop talking and you can listen to someone who is actually interesting. So that's the rough structure. I am an academic economist by training, so I'm not accustomed to people being polite. If you have any questions, just start shouting them out. If I don't seem to be paying attention to you, I am quite old and so deaf, so start throwing things, soft things first, sharp things later. Okay? Ground rules, well established. Don't throw things at Kate. You wouldn't like her when she's angry. So, who are you? So, the Behavioural Insights team. We were set up in 2010 by our then coalition government. This was a combination of the Liberal Democrats, who, as it turns out, weren't that liberal, and the Conservative Party, who, it turns out, weren't that conservative at the time. But my, how things have changed. Let's say you're recording this. Are we putting this on the internet? So we were set up with a broad mandate to apply behavioural science to policy, behavioural science meaning psychology, behavioural economics, and really anything else that we thought might work from a broad academic literature, including anthropology, sociology, and whatever we read on the back of the cereal packet that day. When we were set up under the auspices of a man called Steve Hilton, who now teaches, I think, at Stanford, and who has a reputation, had a reputation, it persists, of being a little bit wacky and a little bit of a lunatic. This reputation, I can say, was fully and richly deserved. And so when people said we're going to set up this team, this nudge unit to do behavioural science, a lot of experienced professional civil servants were very sceptical that this would last very long. They're accustomed to new prime ministers coming in and having brilliant wheezes about how we're going to solve everything by means of X, Y, or Z, starting at homeopathy and working down towards behavioural insights, which is the only time I'm ever going to use those two words in the same sentence. And so the civil service sort of, I think, expected us to go away after a certain amount of time. And those of us who didn't expect us to go away thought they could probably just get by ignoring us because we would just fade into the background. So in order to sort of earn our place in government, we started by working in the sexiest policy area imaginable, which is tax collection. as you all know, tax collection is, it's where everyone gets up in the morning to find out how tax collection is going. No one cares about social mobility. No one cares about energy policy. It's all about tax collection. So in tax collection, the good thing is, A, it has a very easy to measure outcome measure. We care about money. It's very easy to count. I'm an economist. If it's easy to count, it's good. If it's hard to count, we don't care. So emotions, whatever. Again, not really a joke. So we started off with that, but we also started running randomized control trials. The reason we decided to run randomized control trials rather than just sort of doing a bunch of stuff and saying, isn't it working fantastically, the world's getting better, is because of this level of skepticism. So my boss, David Halperin, is a former academic, but I think he probably would have been fine with us not doing trials, except for the fact that we need to convince people that stuff works. Randomized control trials give you the best possible standard of evidence that a thing is working or not working. So we started off by doing these trials in tax. We found, as I'm sure many of you already know, some pretty significant effects. We can bring for £200 million worth of tax revenue. And the great thing about old people who run government departments is they're happy to ignore you, and then you say £200 million extra a year, and suddenly they're on board and they're on your side. And so that's sort of, I think, how we broke through. So tax collection, rewriting of letters and that kind of thing, it's great. You'll have heard lots about it. It's very easy to hear lots about it. I've always thought that it's just the beginning of what we'd be doing in the Behavioural Insights team. And so I'm going to talk to you about some of the work we've been doing around social mobility and education today, which I think is a thornier issue that historically we haven't been associated with. So Britain holds the dubious distinction, as well as having, I think, invaded more countries than any other one in the world, of being the only country in the developed world where our indigenous population, and particularly our indigenous male population, performs worse academically than every single minority, every single immigrant group outperforms our indigenous, so white working class males in particular, perform just so badly. This is, as I say, a dubious distinction. I think it shows how great we are, as you'll have seen from Brexit, embracing foreigners and letting them into our schools and helping them to develop. But it also shows how great we are at ignoring all of our peripheral regions outside of the southeast. So we really wanted to sort of try and address this problem. One of the fun stylized facts of this problem is that it's not just the fact that the schools which these people are in are underfunded, it's also that there's a poverty of aspiration as well. So there's a great paper by Jake Anders from UCL, which shows that white working class boys, even if they get the top grades at school, even if they're getting 3 A's at A level, so they could go to whichever university they want to, they still disproportionately don't apply to university. And if they do apply to university, they apply to systematically worse universities than similar individuals with the same grades from wealthier backgrounds. Now, in the UK, because we have this marvellous invention called socialism, it doesn't matter how rich you are, everyone can go to university, and in many cases, going to a better university is cheaper if you're poorer than going to a lower quality university. Or sorry, I should say less prestigious, because the government line is that there are no better or worse universities, they're just more or less prestigious. Although how much prestige is achieved is an interesting question you might want to read. So we started working on this problem. We did a series of projects which Oliver partook in. One, he wasn't a white working class boy. He's not British. You may be able to tell from the voice. When he was over with us as a research fellow for the summer, around trying to get young people to aspire higher. One of the most successful interventions we did there was we sent. So we did three things. First, we had a control condition. So that's not one of the three things. That's the fourth thing. Bearing with me on the numbers. Good. The first thing we did was we sent the kids information, so the three little cards that said, it's cheap to go to university, you're going to earn tons more money, and it's a great place to go. And those made people significantly less likely to want to go to university. So it turns out telling people the university is a great idea just doesn't work. Maybe just for you guys, but certainly for the people who we're talking about, it doesn't work. We sent the same cards to their parents, telling their parents, hey, your kids can afford to go to university, it's actually cheaper than you think, it's going to get them chances in life. And that didn't backfire, which is positive, but it didn't do anything at all. Parents either didn't read it or didn't care. The third intervention was we sent somebody from a similar background to these people to a bunch of schools and to give a talk in assembly saying, hey, I was from a school like yours, I'm from a background like yours, I applied to university, I went to university, and it's great and I love it and my life has been transformed by it. And that significantly increased the rate of people wanting to go to university. So it's a self-reported, but it increases the likelihood of wanting to go to university 3 months later by 20%. So 8 percentage points. Pretty chunky effect, which we're really pleased with.
Want to see what actor we used to?
Would you like to, Oliver?
No.
It was me.
Remember I said Michael is from the far west point of the UK?
and turns out he's very popular then when he goes back and gives inspiring talks to young people who don't want to go to university. So it's a Michael Sanders effect, to be sure.
Which is not the title of the paper,
so.
Despite my good wishes. So we did that. Obviously, the time of this individual who gave the talks is a fairly scarce resource, and I decided not to rededicate my life to driving around Somerset giving people talks for the rest of my life. So what I wanted to try and do was take the essential essence of that, which is a message from somebody like you, and then communicate it out in a way that could be scaled up and done in a much larger way. So we worked with the Department for Education, and we got the top 25% of attainment nationally poor kids. So they're in the top 25% of all people in terms of their attainment age 16. But they receive free school meals, which is the proxy we use for not being terribly affluent families. And we sent them a letter. So we had a control condition to get any letter at all. A quarter of the kids received a letter from a chap called Ben Cole, who was one of mine and a colleague's students at Bristol University, who was from that kind of background and gone to Bristol, which is, no one's ever heard of it, but it's an okay university. I should say I went there. It's a very narrow set of people. So they either got a letter from Ben, or they got a letter from a different student of mine called Rachel Prescott, very similar letters emphasising that they were from this kind of background, that they didn't think they could go to university. They ended up going to university and they've loved it, and then talking about the amount of support that's available to them at the university, both financially and culturally. So we had those three, and then the fourth condition got both letters. What we find in the most effective condition, which is not surprisingly sending them both letters, is we go from 8.5% of these young people from low-income backgrounds applying to and being accepted to prestigious universities or selective universities to 11.4%. Sorry, that's written down. So that's it seems like a relatively modest increase, but when you think about the fact that it's sort of 20, 30, 40% increases compared to the baseline, and this is every year from now on because we've now rolled this out nationally, we reckon it's going to be about another 300 young people from these backgrounds who are actually able to get into these elite universities. We don't see any movement on them applying to university, period. So they are still, it's the same kids applying to universities, applying to better universities, which we're pretty happy with. We obviously want to go back and look and see what we can do next to get more people to apply to university. So these are relatively light touch interventions. Yeah?
Have you tested face-to-face versus someone coming and talking to them?
Face-to-face versus someone...
face-to-face versus a letter.
We haven't done those. So we had a similar thing, which is trying to get people from low-income families to take up a four-week social action project, which is basically 4 weeks of residential support and everything for helping their communities. We found that a video was more effective than a face-to-face talk from a graduate. We think the reason for that is because the graduates were typically 18, and so... I mean, I'm 29 and I've been doing this for a long time. I still get anxious talking to people when I was 18 that don't know how many words I would have got out before I completely froze up. So the video works significantly better than the face-to-face talk, but we haven't tried it in this context yet. This is something for future work, yeah.
Just following up on that, how important is it for you to understand the mechanism that's going on versus just the effect on stuff?
So I care about both of them. I think the mechanism for me is a second order consideration. So the reason I care about mechanism is so that I can work out what's most likely to work next time. And when this stops working, because it will at some point, so that I have an idea of what's going on in people's heads is stopping them from applying. So when we did the initial study in Somerset with the backfiring intervention, we thought that the mechanism which was stopping people from applying to university was they were misinformed about the costs, the financial benefits, and the costs of going to university. We found that doesn't seem to be the case. It seems to be that it's actually more of a people like me kind of phenomenon. So we had behind the sort of headline results, we had a fairly detailed survey we asked them about some facts about university, so how much does it cost, how much do you earn afterwards, what kind of support is available. And we found that moving, in case anyone's interested, this is instrumental variables, so not a perfect approach. We found that moving their facts about university doesn't move their likelihood of wanting to apply or the likelihood of applying at all. What we found is that moving their sort of emotive responses, so questions like people who go to university have more rewarding lives, university isn't for people like me, obviously when I want to go down, and people who go to university have more interesting friends, moving those measures experimentally is much more associated with increases in applying to university. So we care about the mechanism, but as I said, mainly because I care about the outcome and I want to work out how the next thing I do is most likely to move that outcome.
So, but with that particular study that you did, you seem to have anchored on saying that it was the messenger, and a messenger like me seemed to matter.
Yeah.
What was the kind of legend there? Was
experimental, is that theoretical?
So I'm not a theorist. So we did we had quite a lot of field work beforehand, so we interviewed a bunch of kids and their teachers and some parents and said, why don't you go to university? And lots of the teachers said, the money is the reason that I'd go to university, and the sense we were getting was from some of the students was also that, but some of the students also said that university isn't for people like me, and particularly to the archetypal British universities are Oxford and Cambridge, where like people wear gowns to dinner, and they're in these colleges with the beautiful quads, and the archetypal person who went to these places, is David Cameron, our former Prime Minister, who went to Eton, which costs £30,000 a year to go to, which is 50% more than the median income. So like, we have sort of got the sense from observation and from interviewing people that there's a social divide. I wouldn't say it was terribly theoretical. I didn't solve an optimization function or anything like that.
I have a question.
Yeah.
So how often are your interventions, you know, based in theory? Like for that example you said, it was based off of prior...
So it depends what you mean by theory.
Like prior research showing that, you know, people are more willing to do things that other people that are similar to them will do.
Sure. So I would say probably 80% of the time there is some underlying theory behind what we're doing. Of that 80%, probably a half is multiple theories. So we're not trying to explicitly tease out a mechanism that's going on. We're just trying to fix a problem. So we'll chuck what I would call a kitchen sink approach. Try everything, see if it works. But some of the times it's just, hey, we think role
like
models
intuition,
might work.
Yeah.
And like, I don't think role models might work is a theoretically like derived intervention. However, if you want to go and find an academic literature on role models working, you can definitely find it.
Yeah,
that, so.
I'm sure.
Yeah.
So I'm more familiar with how the legal framework works around more academic research processes of like getting participant consent and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
What's the legal framework when it's like the public at large working with?
So in general, we don't get consent from participants. In general, government doesn't when it's going to do things. The way I think about it is removing from arbitrary to random. So government is going to do some stuff to some people in some areas, and we've moved from, we think we might want to win that seat in the next election, so let's pump some money into it. Or this minister had a conversation with someone from that seat, so let's like try this thing. Or a guy from a charity made a donation to your cause and to your party, and so you think this intervention is going to work because of the donation. We moved it from that to let's do it randomly so that we can work it out.
Do you think this is a matter of self-efficacy then? Of people believing that they actually, that this is an attainable and realistic goal for them?
It's unclear. So I think for some people that's definitely the case. My sense with the people who get these good grades, so they must have enough, they have enough self-efficacy to be getting in the top sort of 2 or 3% of grades nationally, despite being at typically lower quality schools and having all the cards set against them. I don't think they have a lack of self-efficacy. I think it's the value of the thing of going to university they don't see, and they don't see it as being culturally the kind of thing. So, like, so if I, what's the, a stupid way of thinking about it, so here's one, would be to say, like, it requires roughly the same amount of self-efficacy for me to go to a football match as it does for me to go to the opera. Roughly the same cost, roughly the same amount of time consumed, roughly the same amount of travelling. I have to be able to sit down. It's just I don't think the opera's for me because I think it's probably boring and for posh people, whereas I think football is for me because I'm from a working class background. So what we're trying to, but in this case, I don't care, but like if going to the opera made you earn £300,000, about $450,000 or more over the course of your lifetime, then maybe government would care. So that's my, I don't say theory, interpretation, but yeah.
Is there an issue of loss there? In the sense that if you move to, in this case, to a different socioeconomic, you feel that you're leaving behind or losing what are your roots, etc.
So I think that might be the case. So there's so Ron Fryer talks about sort of people acting white in this country. I think in the UK, certainly among the people I grew up with, there was more of a phenomenon which I haven't tested empirically because I'm not Ron Fryer, of sort of acting posh, which is to say this isn't the kind of thing that people like us do. Like we don't study, we don't work hard, because that's what rich people do.
Is it in England, in the UK? I mean, the class system is quite strong. Moving from class one class to the other, you always remind where you come from.
Yes, I mean, we have, I would say, higher levels of social mobility, I think, than our American cousins, but yes. but worse than our European cousins, so yeah. But I feel like, so I don't know, yes, class system is still a thing. I think you can get out of it much more straightforwardly now. So like, there's a huge pooling in what I would think of as being the middle class, which you can enter just by being able to use this voice rather than my regional accent. But I don't know. So there's a line from My Fair Lady, which is, as soon as an Englishman opens his mouth, he makes some other Englishman despise him, because it's all down to voice. But I think that's, I hope, less strong than it was in the late 19th century, but I don't know. I've only ever lived in one country. You guys probably know better than me. I'm now out of time.
Yeah. Do you want to say a few more words to close up, or should we switch over again?
Let's switch over again.
Okay.
Thanks. Well, speaking of voice, as an Australian in England, I can say voice matters. And one of the things I really missed when I moved from the US, where people think Australian accents, if they can tell that, if you can hear the difference between me and Michael, you might think it's quaint and sweet. In the UK, it's unfortunately very much associated with our convict background. So I can attest to that. What I cannot promise in my short speech is being as funny as Michael Sanders, but I may promise speaking slightly slower. So for those of you who for whom English is not your first language, hopefully this is more comprehensible. So
it will.
So
mostly edged, yeah.
With love perfection. So I work at the Behavioural Insights team. I don't work in the full-blown geeky part of the team that Michael heads up, mostly because my STATA skills are not up to scratch. Don't comment on that, Tom, who had to see some of my STATA skills a few years ago. But I have worked in the team in a couple of different parts of the team, but have spent more of my time over the last year working on a new technology product that we've developed to try to take the bias out of recruitment decisions. And you might think, it's a slightly weird place to end up, but actually it sort of all stems from much the same motivation that Michael talked about, which is that we've spent a long time thinking about ways in which we can use government policy to improve social mobility. And I was really struck by a series of studies that have been done by people at this university and all around the world on the kind of disproportionate rates at which people get called back for interview when sending the same CV but changing the name. So for those of you who are not familiar with the very niche literature that is auditing and correspondence studies, the basic design is you take two CVs that are precisely the same, applying to the same job, and change the name at the top of them and just see whether or not name seems to matter for whether or not you get called back for interview. And sadly, lo and behold, it does. They've run studies now in about 30 countries, and we find that about 40 to 75% chance of you are 40 to 75% more likely to get called back for an interview if you have a white-sounding or a native-sounding surname, which to me just seemed kind of crazy because there's nothing about my name that tells you whether or not I'm going to be good at my job. And it seemed to me that coming from a world in which people are hiring daily, that maybe there are parts of the systems that we could design that help them to not fall into the traps of kind of discriminating against people in completely biased fashions. So we started on this sort of pathway when we were doing a series of literature reviews, which are available online in case you're interested in kind of behavioral science, recruitment and selection. We were also doing work with a bunch of public sector organisations in the UK, including with police forces that were interested in increasing the ethnic representation of their police forces. We were also doing work with the likes of Teach First on do small changes to the way that you craft an email, change the nature of who applies for a job, and what the kind of quality of those applicants might be. Each of these pieces of work kind of led us to believe that there is a lot to be gained from applying small and often very cheap interventions to recruitment processes, and they can have meaningful impacts on people's likelihood of succeeding through recruitment processes. And one of the things that we got out of this sort of evolution of the team as we've grown over the last 5 or 6 years is that we are now co-owned by an innovation charity in the UK, which allowed us to tap into some grant funding to develop products and services. So a lot of what the team does, a good 95% of what the team does, is applying behavioural science or rigorous evaluation methods to the way that policy is designed and delivered. But there are occasional instances where we thought, actually, government doesn't have the lever here. It's the private sector or it's the third sector that actually affects the outcomes that we care about. And an example of that could be thinking about work that we've done with pension providers, for example, where government has a keen interest in the outcome of people saving more for their retirement, but they're not the ones that you save with. Pension providers are the ones you save with. So we've partnered with pension providers and worked with government organisations to do that kind of work. In our line of work, we were thinking, well, it's actually most of the private sector organisations out there doing the hiring and firing, so we need to think about ways in which we put the behavioural science in their processes. So we started on what's now been a kind of year and a half long journey, which Oliver has also partaken in, for Oliver gets drawn into all of our work, to test very, very micro aspects of how we can add behavioural science to the way people select people for jobs. And I thought one of the things that I could kind of touch on, which Oliver mentioned that last week, you talked about use of MTurk, and some of you might have signed up to MTurk last week in one of your sessions. Does that ring a bell? Yeah. So for those of you who don't know, MTurk is a online labour market. Essentially, it's a bunch of people who do small tasks in exchange for money. It's just basically a freelance labour market for small things. And researchers are increasingly using this population to pre-test interventions before they roll them out in much more expensive settings. And for those of you who are sort of research inclined, you're probably thinking, well, how much does an online population represent the broader population you're actually interested in, and is there external validity to that? Oliver is much more of an expert in this than I am, but the headlines are a lot of psychologists have tried to replicate known findings in field settings on MTurk and found that to remarkable success, they tend to bear out. So for a lot of basic things, we're finding it's a reasonably good experimental population to try things on. And it's typically quite cheap and quite fast to get results. So I thought I might touch on, while a lot of what the team does is gets out there in the messy but far more interesting and important world of field studies, we also do use MTurk to kind of pre-test important aspects. And we, in the applied world, which is the name of the platform, we've used MTurk studies to test very specific design features of the technology. So we've used MTurk to test what is the optimal number of people that you would get to review recruitment or candidate information to make sure that you minimize the risk that you get idiosyncratic bias. It turns out that it's 3. For our purposes, we think you massively reduce the risk of judgmental inaccuracy or bias by getting 3 different people to independently assess candidates' information. We've also used MTurk to test a bunch of other kind of niche but potentially interesting to this audience's interests around, are there ordering effects? So one of the kind of classic aspects of behavioural science is that how you read information matters, right? So what you read first, we all know the menu effect. You're going to be much more likely to pick the things that sit at the top of the menus, but particularly if you have less interest in, you know, pouring down to page 3 of a menu. Well, one thing we were particularly interested to test is there some impact of the order in which you get read? So if you're a candidate and you've applied for a job, it's most likely fairly arbitrary the exact moment in which you hit send on your email to send in your application, with the exception of the kind of 11:59 p.m. before the 12 o'clock deadline, which, you know, you get a massive spike in people who apply for jobs. But what this might give us is a sense of when you are going to be reviewed. So most people will apply for jobs, it'll go into an email system, and then that will get put into another folder, and then that will get printed out probably top to bottom. So there's some kind of randomness to the order in which you're read. As it turns out, when we tested this on MTurk, we found that that randomness actually matters. So we found in one particular MTurk study that if you gave a very poor response to a particular recruitment question, that the next 5 or so people got a bump, which is to say there was almost a contrasting effect happening there. And likewise, we saw, to a lesser extent, but still a statistically significant impact, of reading an excellent response means you're tougher to about the next 5 people, disproportionately. And we could test this because we changed the order in which people read things. So we knew that, sort of objectively, what they should have been given was a 4 out of 5, but they were being given suddenly a 3.5 out of 5. And we found these effects to be quite surprising, probably more than we would have expected. We're going to continue to replicate them in different types of settings. But it's yet another example of how weird and arbitrary the world is, but its impacts can be real on people. So you draw a threshold decision on who you're going to be bringing through to interview or who you might select for a job. And if it's down to like whether or not you read my application after Michael's, it's kind of scary, right?
You get a bump.
Very good, very good. So one of the things that we've built into the system, this might all sound very esoteric, but it's, in a sense, it's quite practical, because we were deciding things like, what is the default for an organisation that wants to use applied to make sure that they hire without bias? How many people should we make sure they get to read candidate information? well, we did this experiment and found we've set it at 3. And you can turn it off before you've had 3 people read, but there's, you know, there's some social norming going on in the platform that says, are you sure you really want to do that? We think you're going to do a better job of getting more accurate responses and more accurate assessments of these candidates if you get 3 people. We likewise also had to make a decision on, do we just allow people to be read one after another, or are we going to change that up? And for the very reason that I just described, we decided that we fully randomize and a bunch of other features. But those are just a couple of ways in which we've used experimental techniques that can be quite fast, quite efficient, and quite cheap to run that actually have measurable impacts on the way that you design systems. And I think what Michael hasn't probably touched on, but what we also do is, before we go out into the field, we sometimes use MTurk to do exactly that. We might have a laundry list of interventions that might go to a wider set of mechanisms that we think might affect a particular outcome, but we want to just get a quick pulse check on which of these seem to be having an effect in this particular setting. That can allow us to whittle 10 potential things to 4, which when running field trials can sometimes be both a complicated and complex task, but also an expensive task that helps you to use public funds and sort of third sector funds much more readily and effectively. So I might leave it there, but happy to answer questions. Yeah.
You said you guys work on, Applied works mainly on the recruitment side of getting things. Do you have you started to work, or do you have any aspirations to work past just the recruitment phase? Or, and secondly, during that recruitment phase, do you also do work on the interview side of things?
Great questions. Yes to both of them. So we've not fully built out the interviewing interface, but we do provide guidance on sort of best practice interviewing. I was joking earlier today that when we first started on this path, we were like, wouldn't it be amazing if you could blind the entire process? So we do blind applications, we chunk them up in a particular kind of way. We joked about, could we have a system where you have sort of like the equivalent of a brown paper bag over people's faces when they're doing interviews, and decided that that's probably not something people are going to use. And being pure about something might not always lead you to actually having social impacts. It's a good example of that. But we do have good practice guidelines on doing structured interviews well. Ideally using multiple people and getting their perspectives, not doing wash-ups, the usual stuff of, you know, the most effective way of getting multiple opinions is to not have people talk about it and not have people be influenced by the kind of most powerful voice in the room. But your question about kind of the post-recruitment phase is a really interesting one. We're interested in lots of different questions there. The most obvious one is performance management. So you can imagine, and we've talked about the challenge here of, imagine we do a phenomenal job. Just imagine we do a phenomenal job of finding much more diverse candidates and doing a much better job of de-biasing recruitment processes. And these people get hired into firms that then are not, you know, for want of a better way of describing it, ready to deal with the diversity, both sort of socio-demographic, but maybe even diversity in the skill sets that they've now hired in. Now, we know from an increasing body of evidence that more diverse teams perform better, but also under the right kinds of conditions. So you could imagine a world in which we do a great job of hiring more diverse people and they flounder and do very poorly in the workplace because that workplace is not well set up for them. And that might lead you to 2 very important problems there. One is like a genuine human problem, which is those people have a terrible experience of it, but also that the organizations may learn the wrong things from that process. Like you could have a massive misattribution problem of saying, well, we tried that diversity thing and it didn't work, so we're going to return to our, we're only hiring from Oxbridge, people with a posh-sounding accent. So we genuinely really care about that outcome, and we think that getting into the performance management space is a way of trying to make sure that you de-bias the kind of long line. We haven't yet done that, but we definitely agree that that's an important part of that. There's also spaces in between that you can do really interesting work, like on induction, just on the onboarding of new people into organizations. And people here at HBS, Francesca Gino, for example, has done some really interesting work on getting people to be in their kind of best headset when they first walk into an organization, and they tend to stay longer and be more effective. So we think there's probably lots of very small, cheap interventions, even if it's down to, you've now hired Michael, here's a pack of, like, if you want to continue best practice, here's a pack of things that you could think about doing. Another example we were joking last week is, I was at a conference last week where the head of Facebook in Europe, who's a woman, was speaking, and she talked about having worked in an organization where it was written into her contract what the length of time between having babies could be. She was told she was not allowed to get pregnant within 3 years, and that was written into her contract. She, in the end, got pregnant within that period of time and caused a bit of a fracas, and in the end she left that organisation. But we were talking about whether or not there's actually just a lot of really cheap and easy things to do about what's best practice employment contracts, and what does that look like, and could you actually, rather than risking having organisations making it up as they go along, or taking what they think is a good example from somewhere else, but in fact doesn't contain the best kinds of conditions there, which maybe the behavioural science of that is just the power of defaults and the power of making what you think best practice is as easy and as readily available as possible. And then there's a whole bunch of other stuff just about what's best practice for keeping people on that you think ultimately will lead to better performing teams.
Yeah. It's clear that there's some of the work that you guys are doing is pretty like translatable globally because it's more like a systemic approach. Do you guys do any like direct kind of consulting with other geographic locations, like nations or governments or private industry?
Yes, we do. So we have, though most of the team is based in London, we have a team that's based in New York. We also have a team based in Australia, and we've just opened an office in Singapore. And probably over the course of the last 5 or 6 years, we've worked with, I think, 22 different countries on various aspects, from very small projects through to helping them to develop behavioural insights expertise in the centre of their own governments, based on what we've learned seem to have worked well. So what are the kind of, I guess, systemic conditions that lead to you being effective? Michael alluded earlier to the choice of your very first projects. I mean, it was very deliberate that we chose tax collection, and in fact, the very specific set of challenges we set ourselves at the beginning were about choosing relatively low risk. Bureaucrats were kind of like, well, if you can get some more money in, great, but we haven't had much luck with this population. You pick kind of easy ins and build some kind of momentum, I guess, behind the approach and think about it from there. So like even some practical things about how to go about doing this work, we've worked with quite a few organisations to do that. But this sort of approach, I think many of you will see, is sort of growing rapidly. I mean, the Behavioural Insights Group didn't even exist when I was here 3 years ago, and yet now I think I see big tweeting weekly on different types of events, so it's really exciting. Yeah.
Is there any difference in terms of how much recruiters are biased across the ladder? So for higher or positions with high responsibility, is there more bias? And you know, I'm thinking if you're looking at, and I don't know the platform that you're using, but I think it's similar to TaskRabbit maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Because if those are like more operational tasks, people may be a little less biased. So if you're doing that in the States, if you see a Latin name, maybe like, oh yeah, you know, Latins are handymen, you know, they're good at that. But maybe they're not good at a higher level position with, you know. So how does that play your research?
Good question. So most of the studies that have been done worldwide have been done on either entry level positions or kind of common positions. So they're like comms manager or sales or whatever it might be, because they were deliberately looking to get external validity of, are we picking jobs that are commonly gone for, and is there bias in those? By virtue of sample sizes, it's incredibly difficult to test like bias amongst decisions around CEOs. And we have yet to run kind of studies of that nature on the platform. It's quite, as I say, sample size makes it quite tricky to be able to detect those kinds of impacts. That being said, there's a lot of interest in organizations about doing both things. So they're worried about the pipeline, so they're worried about making the entry-level positions as even as possible, but also then they see massive drop-offs. So I'm not sure if any of you saw that McKinsey's recently released some work on gender equality in the workplace and just found, you know, actually in a lot of organizations in the UK, for example, it's basically 50-50 gender-wise at entry, but it massively drops off as you get through the organization. So that's something about later on they're not hiring in women as often as they're hiring in men, but again, it comes back to this point of performance management as well.
Hi, I too am a fast-talking musician, so I feel your pain.
Excellent.
Also,
it's their pain, mine's fine.
So before coming here, I was working for a startup inside the Treasury, which died. And so I'm really interested institutionally about how you built influence for something within the British civil service, where I assume most bureaucrats were very resistant.
So David Halpern has a mnemonic for how to set up a successful behavioural insights team. David loves mnemonics. It's apples, which I'm now going to try and remember all the letters of.
So in order to have a successful behavioural insights team, which I think this applies more generally than just behavioural insights team, you need to have administrative support, which isn't to say secretariat. It means, so in this case, the cabinet secretary, the civil service, like, being bought in. I think in our case, that was largely achieved by showing them that we were useful and that we made their lives more interesting. I also think a lot of the early work, and actually quite a lot of the subsequent work, hasn't involved working with the most glamorous people in government. It's about finding the guy in the basement who's in charge of printing off the letters that get sent to people who are late paying their tax. And those guys in general, because nobody above sort of the very junior grades has ever been down to see them, will generally be very happy to work with you. So trying to make other people's lives interesting, I think, helps. And also getting the support, it helps that sort of Gus O'Donnell and Jeremy Haywood were supportive, obviously. If you can get the head of the civil service to be in favour, then that obviously helps a lot. Politics, so essentially if all of our ministers thought that it was a rubbish idea, we were never going to get anywhere. I think you can trade off A and P here, so if you've got a lot of administrative support, so you can get a few things done which you can show the ministers and convince them, which is what our experience with the Home Office has been. This is the department that deals with typically crime and justice and the law. They were very resistant. We got a few officials to like us, and then the ministers have been converted. Third one is people, so who you've got matters a great deal. In the early days of BIT, it was before my time, because I'm not a terribly good academic. There was a lot of very good academics in the team who had no experience of the civil service and so would spend their entire lives. So were you in horse cars?
Yeah.
So the inside baseball. Like the Treasury building, you can get lost in for months at a time. And if you're unpopular and a bit of an academic, people will let you wander around, and the fact that they're at like three orange zones on each floor, it's like, oh yeah, the meeting's in the orange zone, it's like, great, and now where am I going? So having a right mix of people, so you have people who can bring the sort of the stats and the academic side of things, people who can bring the behavioural science side of the academic side of things, but also people who could just get things done, and who are like experienced of working in the civil service, experienced of getting their hands dirty, and people who are charismatic. As I said, I mainly deal with the nerdy, geeky end of things, and Kate's good at everything else, so I think you need to have that nice. Also, she's comprehensible, I think, the word is. Location, sorry to bang on. So location, basically being close to the centre, so Treasury is a great place to start. The fact that Treasury has a sort of slightly, so one of those trees in children's films, that sort of vipers, not of them, the ivy grabs people and strangles them to death. Lovely department. Some of my best friends are Treasury officials. Experimentation, do RCTs, prove that it's working as fast as you can. Like, quick and dirty and done is better than perfect. And then scholarship, so like making sure that you are actually abreast of the literature. There's nothing more embarrassing than sitting in a meeting, particularly on behavioural insights side, where the guy you're talking to, who's not supposed to be a behavioural insights expert, has read a paper you haven't. So that's, I think those are the things that we think are important to success.
So I'm still thinking about this contrast effect, the order effect. So what would be the, I'm trying to think of like the intervention that would kind of solve that. What would that be? Because already, I guess the order is randomized somewhat. Would you just give like a different randomized order to the three different recruiters? And then that would get rid of, okay.
Yeah, I mean, there's always going to be some risk of error there anyway, but we're pretty careful with our stratified randomization to make sure that we Michael's next to mine, and in fact, I didn't quote go into it in detail, but what we do is we also randomise the order in which you're read per question, and there's no way of connecting a candidate through a particular response, so you're reading a bunch of responses to question one, and then a bunch of responses to question two, and it basically just looks like this is applicant 11 out of 22, but actually you don't know that that's Michael is 11, and then he's 2, and then he's 7,
oh,
and then he's 14.
Interesting.
So the whole way through, all you're doing is responding to
the
quality of an individual question. And then that's replicated by three people. So we think we've kind of designed out as much as possible while bearing in mind that this is still people's time in real organisations.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, we had to make some decisions there about minimising risk of bias. But the reason why we did that is one of the tests that we did for deciding that three was the optimal number of reviewers was an MTurk study, as I said. We ran with 400 MTurkers where we sent them all 4 different responses to a recruitment question and got them to rate them on a scale of 1 to 5. And that gave us what the crowd thought the best was, the worst was, and the two in between. And we found we found some interesting things. One was if you left it to one person, even where the best was clearly much better than the second best, they're going to get it wrong 25% of the time, 20-25% of the time. So that's like kind of scary, right?
Yeah.
Like that's like going for a head of research role and I'm applying and Michael's applying and one in four times you choose me over him.
Yeah.
It's not going to be a great outcome,
yeah.
Let's be honest. So then what we did is we were like, well, that's kind of interesting, but the more people you get to review, the you massively reduce that risk of bias, that risk of mistake. And by three people, you've kind of reduced it to 6-7%, which we thought was pretty good. Then we tested a couple of different variants of that, and actually Oliver suggested the most interesting one, which was it was easy to distinguish the best from the next best. But two and three, so the second and third responses, they were much more closely rated.
Mm-hmm.
And why we cared about that was, can you distinguish similar candidates where there is a quality difference between them, but you have to pay a bit more attention? And how many people do you need to do that? We found that distinguishing the second from the third best, if you leave it to one person, they get it wrong as often as they get it right.
Mm-hmm.
And if what you were doing was saying, well, actually, we're only going to interview two people, so you clearly know who your best is, you're going to interview them, but you don't know which of these two other people to interview, there's a real risk there. And we found, again, when you get to about three, you've kind of reduced that to about 15%.
Mm-hmm.
So replicate that over multiple questions and the total randomization, we think we've gotten it pretty good. We're making it as objective as possible.
What does bid work structurally? You have like a research area, you have sections?
So we have three policy clusters, each of which is headed up by a director, and they run a substantive policy area or multiple. So one cluster is health and tax and local government, because death and taxes, haha. seriously. One of them covers home affairs, security, and international development, which is weird. And the third one covers productivity, which is economic growth, education, skills, and consumer affairs and energy.
Yes.
Excellent. Pass the test. So those guys, the people who work in those areas, specialize in a particular policy area. So they specialize in health. These people do the majority of our policy work, so writing notes for ministers, writing ideas, doing literature reviews, that sort of thing. And then sort of across the whole thing sits my team, which does research. So the way this works is, so let's say Kate and I are working on a project together, I would be a research person on the project, Kate would be a policy person on the project, and they've gathered from everything we've been saying so far. Kate would do the finding of the work, she'd talk to the people who we're working with about what the problem is, and then we would work together on the designing of the trial and how we're going to run that and how the interventions are going to work. So typically I would say Kate would do the lion's share of the intervention design, and I would sort of throw stones from a distance. I would do the lion's share of the trial design, we'd run the trial together with the partner, and then I would do the analysis, and then Kate would do the communicating of the results, because I am incomprehensible.
I know that you worked initially, you started at the government, you worked there 2 or 3 years, and then you now came out from the government, basically. And I wondered, how did this affect your effectiveness in terms of working with the government?
So we spun out 2.5 years ago now. We are now a third owned by the Cabinet Office, a third owned by the innovation charity Nesta, that Kate mentioned before, and a third owned as a mutual, so we're all of the public sector reform buzzwords you can think of. So we still have a very, very close relationship with government. We have a framework agreement, which allows us to work very closely with government departments, and we have a lot of work. So we have essentially guaranteed that we continue to provide the same level of service as a number of people to the Cabinet Office where we were before, as we were prior to spinning out. So we still work very closely with government. I think overall our effectiveness has increased since we've left, and the reason I think that is the case is because of people like Kate. There's a reason why it's you. Kate was one of our first non-European hired, because previously we could only hire people who could get security clearance working in the British government, and we couldn't issue visas because we didn't really do that as a government for fairly obvious reasons. Outside of government, we can hire the best people for the job regardless of who they are, and we've somewhat liberated in terms of the scale we can reach. So when we were in Cabinet Office, we were 16 people, and we were trying to work across every major domestic policy area, and run randomized control trials. If you ever tried to run a large-scale randomized control trial, you really want 16 people on each one. So we were trying to run about 20 a year, which wasn't really practical. So we were being able to expand has allowed us to focus much more in much more detail. When I was in Cabinet Office, before I was head of research, my policy areas were crime, justice, a little bit of international development, some education, charitable giving and volunteering, and econometrics. Now people have a thing which they can specialize in, which in large part I think is a good thing. Economist specialization is good. So I think in general our effectiveness has increased. I think we are tackling more thornier problems, so our significant result rate has fallen slightly. And there have been, I'm not going to say there haven't been teething problems in that expansion, but I think in general our ability to work with government hasn't been affected too badly. Our staff are better than they were, and they're really larger than they were before. And we're able to work with a broader range of governments now. So for example, so we work with 22 different countries. A lot of those countries share similar problems, like tax collection. We only have one central government tax collection agency in the UK, whereas if you're working with 20, even things you can learn and try and cross-pollinate ideas, I think is expanded dramatically. So in general, I think good, but I would say that.
All right, maybe that's a good note to leave it on. I think most of you have to head out to another course or class, but if you have some time, I think Michael and Kate are going to hang around for a little bit for questions. Thanks so much again for coming, and I hope you're going to come also for the next lecture we're going to have on Epic, but also look out for emails from us from BIG and Epic, and hopefully this was interesting. Hopefully you see more interesting things, and if you have any questions, let us know. Thanks so much for coming, and thank you very much for